Hi, my name is Vesna Karapetrova and we're here today at Canadian Macedonian Place on May the 19th, 2015 to interview Mr. Steve Pliakes for the Canadian Macedonian Historical Society. Welcome, Mr. Steve Pliakes, and thank you so much for sharing your life story here with us for the archives of the Canadian Macedonian Historical Society. Let's begin with you letting us know a little bit about yourself. Where and where were you born, for example?
Aegean Macedonia.
And what was the village?
Lerinsko Polje, village Zelenice.
That's where you were born?
Yes.
Okay. And how far away from Lerin is Zelenice?
40 kilometers.
About 40 kilometers. And when were you born? The year?
1940.
Now, how about your parents? Can you tell us who they were and maybe even when they were born?
1911, 12, 13, something like that. Both of them, they passed away.
Yeah, what's the name of your father? The name of
Lambo,
your mother?
Lambo, mm-hmm. Gena. Mm-hmm.
And what was their last name?
Lambo Pliakov. Mm-hmm. Gena Bishop Gotis. Gotev.
She was your mother. So yeah. Your mother's name is?
Well, her maiden name was Gotev.
Yes.
Yeah.
Was she also from Zelenice?
All of them.
Yes.
Yeah.
And do you have any brothers and sisters, siblings?
One brother, two sisters, one died.
Okay, can you tell us their names?
George.
Uh-huh. Is George the oldest?
George is the baby. Then there was Helen, who passed away a year and a half ago.
Was she the oldest?
No. From the bottom up, I'm going. And Mary is the oldest.
Mm-hmm. And how about yourself? Are you in the middle or?
After Mary.
After Mary.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And Mary was the oldest?
Yes.
Okay. All right. And can you tell us about your grandparents, what you remember about your grandparents, if you remember anything from the village?
And my father's father, he was a rebel. He was with the committee, mm-hmm. fighting against the Turks.
Yes. What was his name?
Jovan.
Jovan?
Yes.
Okay.
Pliakov.
Jovan Pliakov. Okay.
And my mother's father, he was a bit like a historian in the village, you know. Everybody was a historian, but he was looked and respected by the village people. In those days about politics, he used to know, he read a lot like that.
This is your mother's father.
My mother's father.
And what is his name?
Trpce.
Trpce. Trpce. And how about your grandmother's? Do you remember
Lena
that?
Lena y Magda. Mm-hmm. My mother's mother, Lena, Bab Lena. My father's mother, Bab Magda.
Mm-hmm. And Steve, what year would they have been born, your grandparents? About?
1906, somewhere there.
Around 1906.
Mm-hmm. Right after Linden.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us anything that you remember, any of the stories maybe your dedo or babas told you that are very vivid
I
in your
do.
Mind?
Uh-huh. In 1906, right after Linden, when my dedo and baba were getting married in the village, the Greek bishop from Koster sent an army in their house, killed 16 people. So goes the story, that was the Karababa Svadba.
For your dedo and baba.
Yeah, the Greeks say the Turks did it. No, it was the Greeks that did it. Mm-hmm. It's official. They want to escape it.
The wedding in blood.
Yeah.
Right. So can you tell us a little bit why they came to do this horrible thing?
No, we were anti-Greek. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're patriotic Macedonians. But that time they called you Bulgarian. Mm-hmm. The Macedonian part wasn't heard of as much. Now we are Macedonian, but that time it was all Bulgarian. Mm-hmm.
And then your father, this was your grandmother, your grandfather that had the tragedy happen in the village because he was a comita?
No. The tragedy happened because the Greeks did not want to see a Macedonian wedding, a Bulgarian wedding in the village. Get rid of all of them, destroy them all. That was my mother's father and grandmother. That's when they were getting married. But they survived because they were upstairs. But the Greek committee, whatever they were, they shot everyone. Mm-hmm. 16 people.
And some of them were your relatives, most definitely.
Tsilocilla. What would they be doing to the wedding?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes. And Steve, can you tell us what language you heard your grandparents, your parents speak of in the village?
Nesboruame literaturno makedonski.
And your parents and the grandparents, everybody spoke Macedonian in the village?
Same.
Mm-hmm. And how about your aunts and uncles? Do you remember a large extended family of having aunts and uncles?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
My father had three brothers. Mm-hmm. My mother was the only one in the family.
And where were they born?
Celio Celto.
Everybody?
Everyone in the village.
Was born in the village?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And how old were you, Steve, when you came to Canada?
11.
So do you have some recollections, some memories of life in the village? Do you remember?
Very much.
Can you tell us what you remember? Some of the memories that are vivid from the time that you were there?
I was trying to make friends. Mm-hmm. I wasn't old enough to go to the coffee place where they played cards. Mm-hmm. I was younger.
And how big was your village?
At the peak period, over 2,000.
When you were there?
In that period.
So this would be around 1945,
1947? Yeah. Well, 1947, then Greece evacuated the village. They were accusing us of feeding the gorillas, which I was for it. Mm-hmm. And maybe we were, and they evacuated, and then they sent us in exile to Patili.
Okay, so talking about the village, your village life, and what memories you have of your village life. You mentioned that you were trying to make friends because you didn't go to school. Tell us about that.
Well, the schools were closed due to the civil war. Mm-hmm.
And this would be
1947, 48.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you didn't have a chance to go to grade one or two?
I did one or two, but didn't pass it. Mm-hmm. It was war that time, yeah.
And what language did you go to the little school that you did go to? What language did you speak in the school?
Well, you should know that. It's Greek.
So it had to be Greek?
Not by choice.
No, but that
by
was
force.
The official.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Okay. And after you started going to school, then you stopped shortly after because...
To come to Canada.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Tell us about when you mentioned that at one point you had to leave your village as a boy and go to another village.
During the Civil War,
yes,
the Greek army thought we were feeding the gorillas in the night, which we did. Mm-hmm. They were right.
So the guerrillas were the Macedonian
partisans
who were fighting?
Yes. It was a civil war, but we wanted to... The new movement then was communism. So we're accepting communism all the way, singing and everything else. And we absolutely had nothing to do with the Greeks. When the Greeks sensed that, well, they did a number. Genocide, ethnic cleansing.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you say that that you were with the partisans, and tell us about that. Why were the partisans started?
We felt they were telling us we're going to get our independence as Macedonians to be recognized and known as Macedonians. So we fought on their side.
On whose side?
Partisante.
Okay.
Yeah.
And who were the partisans with? Were they supported by...
No, they were with... Okay, it started out with Moscow, and then it came with Bulgaria, and then Yugoslavia. That was the power shift that was going on. Mm-hmm. But we just wanted anything to do with our people.
Right.
Nothing to do with the Greeks. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And I can say about 90% of the village people felt that.
That they wanted to...
We wanted our own identity. Mm-hmm. Yeah, as Macedonians.
Steve, you mentioned that you went to school it had to be spoken in Greek, and you went for not for a long time. But tell us about your experience in school, that you had to speak Greek. But what happened if you spoke Macedonian?
Well, you wouldn't dare in the school class to speak Macedonian. You wouldn't dare. The teacher would really give it to you. He carried a long stick.
Yes.
He hit you, didn't care where he hit you. And I got hit.
So you remember being hit?
Oh, yes.
Why would you get hit?
You just asked a question because I was speaking Macedonian.
With your friends? Like,
yeah, who else? But you didn't do that. When we got out of the classroom, outside of the schoolyard, then we spoke Macedonian, and then I got... He caught me speaking. He really gave me a few slaps in the face for speaking that language.
Even at recess, when you were not in
yes,
the school?
Yes,
Even if you were in the school?
They wanted the Macedonians to be out of the country or sign here and become a Greek. You denounce everything else. So none of us would want to do that.
And right.
So they took a little hatred towards us because they wanted to, even to this day, I'm actually banned from going to Greece for that reason. Mm-hmm. Every time I go, they kick me out.
Okay, we'll get to that a little later on. Right now, let's just concentrate on your childhood, your life as a child. Do you have any recollection? You mentioned your village was quite large,
mm-hmm.
right? How many houses?
I'd say 300-400.
That's quite a large.
Yeah.
So tell us about your life as a child growing up.
I loved it.
Uh-huh. What were some of your wonderful memories?
Well, we had our festivities.
Yes.
As Macedonians. Kagovelet Panagir.
Yes, so you had celebration,
yeah.
religious
yeah, we,
celebrations.
We did all of that. And
How was it celebrated? Tell us.
Dancing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and all the village wives, mothers would bring the food in and we would eat.
So where would this take place?
Just from the village. There was a little monastery, a little bit up the hill, and that's where we gathered, all of us.
Do you remember the name of the monastery?
Sveta Petka.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And you remember having happy times there?
Yes.
And what language did you speak among yourselves when you were celebrating?
Macedonian.
And the music? Dancing?
Macedonian.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You remember
sure.
words being sung
well,
in Macedonian?
Same stuff you hear when we dance. Elena Mome, Tovato, you know, the same music that's all we know. It's our
yes.
history.
What work did your parents do in the village, Steve?
Farmers.
For a living?
Farming.
And how about the rest of the village? What was their occupation?
Agriculture, all of them.
What kind of crops did they look after?
Vegetation, like potatoes, cucumbers, tomatoes, for ourselves. We didn't sell them, you did them for yourself. And to preserve for the winter, you better have it.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a good life.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody was hungry. And it was nice, it was good. But the problem, again, I'll state, it's too bad in 1913 when they partitioned us, the European powers, and they totally demoralized all Macedonians. We were totally sad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And so, Steve, you mentioned going to school for a little bit. Do you remember who your friends were and what you did after school?
Most of them are here in Toronto.
Yes?
Yeah.
Yeah. And what kind of games did you play together after school when you were away from the schoolyard?
At that time, soccer, you call it football.
Yeah. In Macedonia, what did you call it?
Bala.
Bala, okay.
Yeah. But we couldn't afford a soccer ball. We used to use tin cans.
Yes.
Kick them around. I'm sure your husband did the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd kick the cans around and then they would run around and score. And some of those cans really were actually with shorts. And I still have a mark on one of my legs where it went right through the can.
And what language did you speak together with your friends?
Macedonian.
When you were
only in the school room was Greek. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's it.
Okay, and so then as you were growing up, you mentioned that you had to leave your village. Tell us about that and go to Patele.
Oh, we got evacuated by the Greek army because we're supposedly, which is true, we're feeding the gorillas.
So this was about 1947. Seven, and you were about 7 years old?
Yeah.
Yes?
But you remember everything. Over there in the old country, at 7 or 8, you're almost mature.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what do you remember about that evacuation? Everybody from the village had to leave?
Yes, all of them.
Mm-hmm. What was that like? Tell us.
Sad.
Mm-hmm.
You left some of your animals behind. You left all your furniture and everything else. Mm-hmm. It was very sad.
So do you remember like what explanation they gave you? Why did you have to leave? Did they give you any explanation?
You're feeding the gorillas at night. Because gorillas would come at night, the army in the daytime.
So the gorillas were the Macedonian partisans fighting for Macedonian
independence.
Rights. Yes.
Okay. Yes.
And was it an event where somebody came to tell the whole village to go?
The army. You're out.
So you saw the whole army come and...
No, they would come over and say, tomorrow you're leaving. You're going to go to Patali. And some to Servicvo. Wherever the army held the territories, that's where you went.
So which army was this?
The Greek.
The Greek army. So what happened on that day when you had to go to Patale?
Well...
You were told?
Through friends or relatives, you found a little room to live with them and share everything. And then we lived in one room, about 10, 15 people.
So your whole family went?
Yeah, and my aunt, because her husband was, my uncle was in jail by the Greeks.
Why was he in jail?
Being Macedonian.
What happened? Do you remember that story?
Greece wanted to annihilate all the Macedonians by any means. I'll say it over and over, by ethnic cleansing or genocide.
Right.
And if they had something on you, you paid for it.
So this gentleman that was your uncle?
Mm-hmm. My father's brother.
Was just being himself Macedonian? Was he speaking Macedonian, or why did he go to jail?
Because our family was labeled communist.
Yes.
And Macedonian and communist, that's the dirtiest word to be.
So he was put in jail?
Yeah, for about 5 or 6 years.
Just for speaking Macedonian?
Yes, being. Because you're labeled.
Yes.
Remember one thing, Greece had one idea. Get rid of him. Mm-hmm. This is Greece. Or sign, you're Greek. I asked my father once, why did you sign? Why did you not sign? You're Greek. He said, are you crazy? How could you just sell yourself? So, I don't know, there was a little problem there, signing or not signing. But anything we did was not deliberate.
Right. And then as you traveled to Patele, can you tell us about that? Did you go by foot? Did you... What happened?
Oh, for sure by foot.
Uh-huh.
And you had, not all of us, a cart drawn by a bull.
With all your belongings that you could take? Food?
As little as you could take, not all.
What did you take mostly?
Well, the closings and immediate survival. The grains. Grains last longer, like potatoes, wheat, rice. That's the stuff the ladies cooked with.
So you loaded up the cart with the donkey? Or the horse?
The bull.
The bull.
No,
the
horse.
Bull.
You've got to be rich to have a horse.
So you loaded up the cart and the bull pulled it from your village.
To the other villages,
To Patale. Yeah. How long was that trip? How long did it take you to walk?
Patale is from my village was about 24, 25 kilometers.
Mm-hmm.
That was it.
Was this just your family walking or lots of other families? The whole village, everybody was walking.
At different times.
Like
they didn't set one date, but they said out.
Right. So in a few days, people left.
Yeah,
so tell us what happened when you arrived in Patele.
Well, the people were decent.
Were they What nationality were the people?
Amelie, why do you ask that? Macedonci.
They were all Macedonians.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
What do you expect? You want me to say the word Greek? No.
No, I'm not. I'm just saying so that we can have it documented that you went to a neighboring Macedonian village.
Yes.
Where you were greeted by friendly Macedonian
yes.
people.
But the guerrillas did not go there at night. So that's why the army felt safe. We were feeding the guerrillas. So that's why they wanted to get rid of us, to starve the guerrillas, supposedly.
Understood. Mm. And when you arrived in Patele, tell us what happened.
Yeah, it was good. It was nice. They were good people.
So they took you in? A family took
yeah,
you in?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They were decent people. Mm-hmm. Well, whatever, they shared with us.
And how long did you stay in Patele?
I would say a year and a half.
You lived in the
same... My brother was born there, George.
Okay.
The younger brother, yeah, he was born there. Mm-hmm. And... Okay.
Were you living with one family or did you have another house?
No, a house, a room, two families in one room.
Okay.
I was going to give you that. These houses belong to the locals.
Yes.
And they said, okay, I've got a room for you coming over here. Stay mm-hmm. there. And
so your whole family stayed in that room?
Yeah, mm-hmm. yes.
Okay, so you stayed in Patele for a whole year?
About.
Yeah. What do you remember about the life there? Did you go to school?
Or? No school. Mm-hmm.
You were like refugees.
We were refugees and we're just passing time, just waiting for the moment we can go back to the village.
Mm-hmm. Did you hear anything about what the partisans were doing?
Oh yeah, a lot.
Tell us.
The rumors were there.
What were the rumors?
Well, our people were gaining the war. Of course, that didn't make Greece happy. They were gaining. Until they decided to shift politics, they forced poor Tito to close the border, because that's where our arms were coming from, Yugoslavia. Mm-hmm. They forced Tito to close the border, so no more arms, and then we started losing the war after that, and mm-hmm. it was hell.
Right.
Yeah.
So you were there when
yes.
the partisans started losing. Tell us about what you experienced. As a child.
It was sadness. Mm-hmm. It was sad to...
Did a lot of people lose their lives?
I remember one night, the Macedonian guerrillas attacked Srbica. They attacked it, but they didn't make a fast run in the morning to escape. There was a late departure. And then in the morning, as they were leaving the village, Srbica, they had to, the mountains there were barren, no trees over there. And the Greeks, with their little shitty airplanes, came over and bombed the hell out of the soldiers running, men and women. And then they went and brought them to Srbica in the center of the town, paraded the dead, the wounded, and the living in the village. Those that were dying, they would cry for water, they wouldn't give them. I was there about 8 or 9 years old
you
watching.
You saw this?
Yes, I did. They wouldn't give them water, they kicked them. You're a communist! I don't know where the heck they got that dirty word, they called it bad. Anyway, and for sure, those were almost dead, and the dead, they put them in the back of a truck, got a bulldozer, open a hole and dump them all in. Mm.
That's a horrific experience for a child.
Greeks have a good record.
Were you, like, do you remember how you went to Srbica? Like, was it people wanted to go there to see the muscle?
No. This was part of Srbica and Patlia, about 5 kilometers.
Okay.
And so we preferred to go to Srbica. I don't know why. Patlia was just a little village. They had stores in Srbica.
Srbica had stores.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You happened to be there?
We moved later. Yeah.
Oh, you went to Srbica later?
Yeah, we shifted.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you, on this particular day, you happened to be in Srbica when you noticed the tragedy.
Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. we did. Yeah. I do recall seeing at the schoolyard where they brought all the dead and the wounded. And they were crying for water. They wouldn't give nothing. Like anything you wanted, they hated you. Mm-hmm. So they wouldn't give them anything. And
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't shoot anyone, but they punished them.
Mm-hmm. And then what happened, Steve? You were only a child, about 8 or 9 at this point?
Yes.
And did you come to Canada shortly after?
52.
So how old were you when you came to Canada?
I'd say 11 or 12.
11 or 12. So what happened
in between?
You were in you lived in Patele for about a year.
Yeah.
Did you have a chance to return to your village?
No, after that, the army says, you can go back in now. We killed them all. We killed all the guerrillas, now you can go in, you're safe. Like,
so
we wanted to be with the guerrillas, but, you know.
They evacuated you.
No, we left on our own. Go back. No more. Evacuation was from the village out.
Right.
Now go in, go anytime you want.
And then what happened?
We went to the village. There wasn't raided or anything. Okay. Grass was about 2 feet tall and mm-hmm. everywhere. And it was like any abandoned village. It looked like that, you know.
Mm-hmm. So then you started to picked up from there. What did you do? What did your family do?
Well, go back to the fields, a garden field, and mm-hmm. make some food.
Right. Now, you told us something about you had an idea when you were there, you couldn't wait to grow up. Was it?
I wanted to join the guerrillas.
Yeah. So when was that, Steve? When you were in Patele or?
No, before we got evacuated.
Yeah. So tell us about that.
Even as
a small child, you were eager
to
grow up?
The patriotic urge was there for everyone, boys and girls.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to, but the official partisan way was you have to be at least 13 mm-hmm. to join. But they used to say you could run up to them, pretend you can lie and all that. But I was just short in size anyway. And still young, I didn't run away. I couldn't, as much as I wanted to, not old enough.
But you had that desire to.
Oh, very much.
And you said many of the boys, many of the young people had that desire.
Well, some went, some left at night. You go up the mountain.
So what was it, Steve, that motivated people, young men and women, to go and fight?
Patriotism.
Tell us about
your identity.
Mm-hmm.
You should never, once someone takes your identity away, your soul is destroyed. Then you don't exist. Okay, and the Greeks did all of that and cut our language from speaking. So that's the worst suffering you can have. You can starve a person, you can amputate, but you take their soul, you destroy the person.
And this was what motivated the people to go and fight for
their
rights.
Yeah, for sure.
Because they felt it.
And there were a lot of Greek communists from the south. We didn't have Greeks up there. From the south, they did the same thing, fighting for the Greek guerrillas. Yeah.
So were the Greek guerrillas connected with the Macedonian partisans at that time?
Ideologically, we had a little battle between the Greek guerrillas and the Macedonian guerrillas. Because the Greek guerrilla says, no, if there's going to be an independence, you're not going to be independent Macedonians. You're still going to be under Greece, but not under capitalism. You'll be a communist Greek.
Mm-hmm. Well, did they offer any language rights to the Macedonians?
Are you kidding?
You don't think so?
Language rights? Mm-hmm. They wanted to get rid of you, kill you.
No, I mean the Greek Communist Party.
Well, they said you can have that.
They said.
But no, you would not have an independent Macedonia.
Mm-hmm. So that was the big disagreement?
Well, that's what we wanted.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. So before you came to Canada, Steve, you went back to your village and life continued. Tell us about those years. Just before you came to Canada, you went back to your village, right?
Oh, from Sumitra.
From Patele.
Yeah, yes. We did. Well, like I said, we went back to start where we left off, work in the fields, in the garden, and hey, it was survival.
Were those hard times?
We loved it. We were back in the village. We didn't care. We didn't know anything better.
Right. And then how did you come to Canada? Who arranged for you to come to Canada? What happened there?
My father had to run away from the Greeks because they were chasing him to kill him. Because his brother was in jail. I remember I said,
yes.
Some island, they call it Macronis, a small island in the Aegean.
Oh, his brother was in the
islands? Yeah, in there.
Yes.
And so
deported.
My
yes.
father had two brothers in the States. They sent him a visa, American visa. He came to the States for a year and then couldn't get any more extension to the visa. And he applied to come to Canada, and Canada says, yes, you can come on one condition. There's no work here. You have to create your own jobs. So his brothers helped us buy a farm in Windsor. That's where we settled from the village. We settled Essex County near Windsor.
Okay, what year did your father come to Canada?
49.
1949. Yeah. And when did you come to Canada?
52.
So from 1949, your father started to...
Well, 1 year in the States. Okay. Then he came to Canada, mm-hmm. worked as a laborer through with farmers. And then his brothers bought him the farm.
So his brothers were already here?
Yeah, they were well off, yeah.
Your father's brothers?
Yes.
How many brothers did your father have here?
Those two, the two, mm-hmm. and the one in jail in the island, and my father, four brothers and two sisters.
And the sisters were?
They were married off, they were in Bulgaria.
From?
The village.
From the village they went to Bulgaria when yeah. you came here? Or
No. His sisters were gone there long before. Yeah.
Do you know why they went to Bulgaria?
Well, we used to think that Bulgaria and Macedonia are one and only. Okay? And didn't matter with us, he lived there or there. There was a period of time Bulgaria, according to history, was about 80% Macedonian populated. Then, I don't know what happened in the last 30, 40 years, they started taking a little bit their own patriotism they created. And they sort of took a dislike to us. There is a Macedonian land, but there's no Macedonians living in it. Only Bulgarians.
That's what they say.
That's the way they were labeling us. So we weren't happy with that either. Mm-hmm. But they didn't actually beat us, but they demoralized us. Yeah.
When?
Even to this day.
Right. Can you tell us, Steve, how you came to Canada? Were you with your mother? Because your father was here.
My mother, two sisters, and my brother.
And
we came by ship from Athens
to
Nova Scotia. You know, there's a plaque there with all the names.
Yes. What ship was that? Do you remember the name?
New Greece.
So you came with
yeah.
the ship, and you landed in?
Nova Scotia.
Nova Scotia.
Yeah.
Do you remember about the trip?
Oh, yes.
Tell us something in your memories.
Well,
what was the trip like?
The ship, they had good food, homemade, like Greek food, Macedonian food.
Mm-hmm.
It was all our food.
Yes.
And when we came to Halifax, then we got in on a train, and the train took us to Windsor.
And what kind of documents did you have when you...
Strictly the Greek passport.
So you had a Greek passport?
Yeah,
and so
maybe a visa or something. Don't forget, mm-hmm. I didn't hold the papers.
Right. And now, so you landed in...
Halifax.
And then you took a train?
Yes.
To Toronto?
Yeah.
And where did you land in Toronto?
Windsor.
Okay. Was your father waiting for you?
He was waiting for us there.
Uh-huh.
And then from there... The farm was already bought, but the house, we moved to the farm.
So this was a farm near
the
Windsor.
Uncles bought us a uh-huh. farm. For us, that was a Canadian rule. There's no employment here. Make your own living somehow. So they bought him a 10-acre farm, and that's where we started life.
And where were your uncles living?
In the States.
They were in the States?
Yes.
But they had brought... They
yes.
bought your father a farm in Canada so
mm-hmm.
he could go and bring his
family.
Well,
one was in Detroit, one
okay.
uncle, which is close. They bought him the farm near Windsor.
Mm-hmm.
They were good people. Yeah. Well, that's what all Macedonians do, help each other.
Mm-hmm. It's very generous.
No, it's in your blood.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what work did you do to make a living? What your father, you started right away being on the farm?
He worked for Ford Canada in Windsor.
When he was in Windsor?
Yeah,
yes.
And then me and the family, we worked the fields in the farm, vegetables. And then we used to take them to the market, sell some there. Father would be working at Ford. No, we had a good life.
So you just kind of continued doing the farming that you did in your in Macedonia. You just continued with your family here.
That's all you know.
And how long was that?
Till 1957.
So you came to Canada in
1952.
So for 5 years you lived on the farm.
Yes, in 57 we came to Toronto.
You came to Toronto.
We fulfilled. Canada said, okay, 5 years, you obeyed the rules, now you can move out.
And those 5 years in Windsor, did you go to school?
Yes. Yeah, well, not in Windsor, in a village just there.
There were village, but so you went to school.
Yes.
What village was that? Where did
it
you
was
live?
Called Colchester. In English, Colchester.
Cold?
This Col, C-O-L.
Uh-huh, Colchester.
C-H-E-S-T-E-R. These are English names from villages from England.
So you went to school in Colchester?
Yes.
And tell us about your school life there. What grade did you start? What it was like?
Well, they moved me to grade 2.
Okay.
Because they figured I was old enough.
Mm-hmm.
And I did public school.
So you started from grade 2 and you went to...
To do public school.
To about grade 5 and grade 7,
no,
8?
8.
You finished grade 8 in
Colchester? That's public school, yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Did you have friends?
Oh, you made... That's where life begins.
Yeah. Tell us about those early childhood memories.
They were good. I fell in love with the farm life because we lived in the village. Mm-hmm. And I met friends, boys and girls. We used to go to parties and everything else, and that's where life began.
Do you remember any of their names?
Oh.
No?
It doesn't matter. I used to like all the girls, so I can't remember all the names.
Were any of them Macedonian?
No, none.
There were no Macedonian
No, they congregated
families?
In the cities. They were in Windsor. Macedonians from Boof and Tricia, they were in Windsor.
Did you socialize in Windsor?
My father did.
Your father?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
He used to deliver veggies to the restaurants because they were all in the restaurant business. So he used to take the food there, they would sell them, and then the food from the restaurant, he would take it from the restaurant and feed the pigs.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how we did. We raised pigs also, and chickens.
Mm-hmm. And then, did your family ever go to Windsor for special holidays or anything special, weddings?
From the farm?
Yes.
Always.
So you had a
They used to go, but my mother and father, we were too young, he'd say, you don't need to know nothing.
Uh-huh.
He wouldn't take us anywhere. My older sister, yeah, they wanted to marry her off, yeah, like that.
Uh-huh. Did they succeed?
No.
So what happened after Windsor? You stayed there for 5 years. You had a nice life
then
with your family. How did you come to Toronto and why?
My mother said, I have no life here. She didn't have people. She said, Steve, go to Toronto. There's relatives and then we'll follow.
Mm-hmm.
So my father gave me a little suitcase, $50, put me on the train. He says, go see this uncle and start from there.
So your father sent you?
Yeah.
And how old were you at this point?
That was 1958, 18. But don't forget, I was a country boy. I knew nothing about city life.
So how did you feel about this idea
that she did it for herself. She needed to meet her own people who lived here. But
you were going to be
I preferred the farm.
Yes, you preferred. Mm-hmm. So what happened? How did that conversation go when your mother told you what she thought?
Well, I felt for her. So I moved so I could make inroads for here. So then with father we bought a house and then they all came in. And
so you went by yourself first?
And then my sister came, my older sister.
Okay.
We got ourselves a job and...
And where did you live when you came to Toronto?
Relatives.
So you lived with your...
Uncles. Uncles on my mother's side, aunts and uncles, yeah.
So did they greet you? How did you...
It's all family.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So they knew you were coming,
yeah.
You're going to live with them?
Yeah.
And tell us what you did when you arrived in Toronto.
Started looking for a job.
Okay.
What else can you do? Who's going to feed you?
So this was 1958?
Yeah.
And you were 18 years old?
Yes.
And you were expected to take care of yourself, and not only yourself, but also eventually bring the family down?
learn enough to bring father to build enough nerve to buy a house to bring my mother, because he was scared. Mm-hmm. He's also a country guy too, you know, to come to a big city. Ugh.
So what was your experience like? What happened when you started looking for a job?
I hated it. Mm-hmm. I hated the city and the people. I didn't know anything about red lights, green lights on the road. I thought, what, these stupid people can't cross? There's nobody there, they're waiting.
Yes.
So.
Now what happened? How did you find your first job?
I went knocking on doors at the businesses.
Were these Macedonian businesses?
None.
None. Where did you live, Steve, at this point?
The uncles.
Where did they live in Toronto?
Lauren Lansdowne.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And were there any Macedonians around them at that time?
I wasn't too keen on Macedonian because I was Canadian. Okay, I didn't care about being Macedonian, Bulgarian, whatever. Don't even discuss the word Greek. But I did not care. I just was Canadian. That's all I did. Much, much later, after I met my friends from the village, then slowly that came and crept up, and that's when I became more patriotic. I was patriotic Macedonian, but I was Canadian Macedonian.
Right. So what was your first job when you came to Toronto? How did you start?
Gas station.
Mm-hmm. Tell us where it was, how you got
in
it.
In Toronto, I went knocked on the door. I'm looking for a job. He says, can you know how to pump gas? I said, yeah. Start. Mm-hmm. And we did. Go over there and get yourself your unemployment papers. And I stayed there for whatever, a year or something.
Yes, and then what happened later?
After that, I went and got another job. You improve. And my parents came in.
Which job was that? The second job?
Guest, garage. And ever since, it was always garage work.
So you
I became a mechanic after.
So you went to another garage?
Yeah.
And at this garage, you became a mechanic?
Oh, no. You sign up through an apprenticeship. You have to do 5 years.
Right. Yeah. So that's when you started your apprenticeship?
Mm-hmm.
Your second job?
I went to dealers, not from gas station. Auto dealers, Ford. Mm-hmm. They took me in as an apprentice. And then you have to work so long and then go to trade school so long to get your license.
So how long did you go to?
5 years.
So you worked at the same time in the Ford plant?
No, Ford plant. Ford dealer.
Ford dealership.
Yeah.
Okay. And how did that go? You were by yourself all this time?
No, my parents had come by then. We bought a house.
When you say we, that's?
The family. The ones I mentioned, brothers, sisters, my mother and father.
Did your father come and help you? Like, how did you buy the house?
By then, we all, from the farm money. Don't forget, from 52 to 58, we were saving money. He managed to save enough to buy a house in Toronto.
And when did your parents come to Toronto?
Maybe 60.
So 2 years later?
About.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And when they came, that's when you bought the house together?
Not together. The house was father's house in those days. No such thing together. We pulled all our money there so the family could live.
Yeah. Were you by yourself the 2 years?
And my sister.
Right. But in Toronto, were you by yourself?
With my sister.
Oh, with your sister.
Yeah. I brought her over from the farm.
Okay. And then everybody came 2 years later and your father bought a house.
We all bought the house. He needed comfort.
Right. Okay. And tell us what happened then. Did you continue to work as an apprentice at this time?
I got my license.
Yes.
Became mechanic. More money.
Right.
And I shifted to graduate for more money. All my life I was Macedonian entrepreneur, piecework. Mm-hmm. I made good money. Oh, I loved it. And then I got tired of working for someone. One time I remember at the dealership, I wanted to go to see the village, and the manager wouldn't let me. He says, you can only go for 2 weeks.
This is in Windsor?
No, in Toronto. At the dealer, Ford dealer.
Right, but you wanted to go and see your parents?
To the village.
Village?
Zelenic.
You wanted to go back to Macedonia to see your village?
Yeah, that's long enough. He said, you can't go. You can only go for 2 weeks. I went for a month, came back, and they took me out of the seniority list. you're starting all over again. By then, I became a socialist again with the NDP. Mm-hmm. That at that time was called CCF. Virginia would know that.
So you joined some Canadian political party?
Oh, yeah. And I was a union organizer.
When you were working for Ford dealership?
Yeah, then they found out. They fired me. Mm-hmm. But I organized two dealerships.
Okay. Mm-hmm. This was in
61 or two.
61 or two. Okay. Yeah. And how did you become involved with the union?
Don't forget it. We're Macedonian socialists. Slavs socialists. We weren't capitalists. Well, that fitted me just right to be part of the unions.
Mm-hmm. So you got involved with the unions?
Yes. And I was an organizer, president of our local.
Which union was this?
Steelworkers. Okay. Of America.
For the mechanics?
No. Strictly steelworkers. Not to do that. You're a union member, and then you can have a job anywhere you want. Oh. I organized the dealerships.
Okay.
Okay, so I was doing good. Mm-hmm. Troublemaker, but
so
I was
you're working
good.
As a union representative?
Yes.
Okay. Is this after your apprenticeship or
after
your apprenticship? Yeah. You became a union organizer.
Yes.
Okay, tell us about that.
I love that too, because I'll say it again. Being Macedonian, being a socialist, remember in the village when I wanted to join the guerrillas?
Yes.
Nothing changed. It was all in. And to this day, I voted NDP all my life.
Okay, we'll talk a little bit about that later on. Okay. So what happened after your union representative career? How did that develop?
I bought my own place. After that, a garage.
So you
a house. We moved from Toronto. We went where we live now.
Which is Stouffville.
I bought a house and a garage. And I worked the garage there. And the house, Lily ran the variety store. Oh, she worked. And we were saving money.
So this was in the mid-60s?
Yeah. She's a real miser, Lily.
Yes. Tell us about your wife, how you met her and when.
When I was ready to find, I used to go with Canadian girls. I wasn't happy. I wasn't getting any manja. They would cook me carrots and pork chops. I said, no, this is not the life I want. So I went and found Lily at a dance.
Okay, tell us about that dance. Where did it happen?
Well, it was her village was holding it.
This was village?
Her, Zelenic.
Zelenic had and where was the dance?
Columbus Hall.
In Toronto?
Parliament in Bloor. Okay. Columbus Hall. So I met her there. She was 15.
Is she from Zelenic?
Yeah, born there.
Yes.
So I'm...
She was only 15. Tell us how you met.
Well, she was the most beautiful girl in the hall. So how can you say how you met?
So you met her, and right away when you saw her, you were impressed?
I asked her to dance.
Yes.
And I said, can I buy you a drink? Okay. So I went, she said, ginger ale. I went there, and I told the bartender, put some whiskey in it. And he did. And she shared hers, and I shared mine, and I do recall, as we were dancing slowly, after she had her drink, she got kind of warm. I squeezed her up a little bit, and that was it. That was it.
And then what happened? You fell in love?
She had to tell her parents. We were sneaking out secretly, because the Macedonian said, no, you don't go out till you get a ring, or sort of. Well, so we had to do the sneaky ways.
So did you live near each other at that time of courtship?
She lived St. Clair in the Old Weston Road over there.
And you were at?
I was Eglinton and Dufferin.
So how did you get together? What was the courtship like?
Well, I had a car.
You had a car by
then? Yeah, I used to squeeze her in the car every time I got her. Yeah. That's what happened.
It was love at first sight, right? From
the beginning. Oh, it wasn't ever.
Yes, and then?
Never disappeared.
Wonderful. When did you get married?
65.
Yes, and we have a beautiful picture of you and
your wife.
Yes, tell us about your wedding. First of all, how did her parents feel about you?
When they heard I was Macedonian,
yes.
They flipped.
They were so happy.
Yeah. Yes. Well, first they asked, did he have teeth and hair? Mm-hmm. That was approved. Uh-huh. And then is he Macedonian? Lily said, yes, all the way. He's in. He's our guy. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of what happened. And I I wanted to get married and went to Sincero Methodist, signed the papers with the whatever, a Benicene, a Zelevo priest. Mm-hmm. And Lily says to me, Steve, there's a Macedonian church independent, they call it St. Clement's in Toronto. She says, why don't we go there?
What year was this now?
65.
So the Macedonian church would have just been built at that time.
Yes. And I said, okay, we went there, found Pope Thomas, and immediately we signed. I went back to the Sincero Methodist. I said, okay, I'm going over there. He says, it's okay, it's ours too. Uh-huh. And Pope Thomas says, Steve, the chapel isn't ready, the church itself, the hall. He says, I'll marry you here in the hallway. He says, if you can do it, do it. And he brought the icons. I couldn't care less. They circled us around, changed the crowns. I couldn't wait till to get a hold of Lily, so we did all that and honeymoon.
Then where did you go for your honeymoon?
NASA, 3 weeks. I was broke because I couldn't balance my budget.
But you went for honeymoon in style.
Yeah, 3 weeks, broke. And that's okay. It was good moments. And she was never argued, never fought, mind you. To understand women, you have to be a genius, and you just give up. You don't try to understand women, and that's it. Mm-hmm. You should know that.
Yes. So then, when you met Lily, then where did you live when you came back from your honeymoon?
Well, poor Lily, she got herself pregnant. So, started crying. What am I going to tell my parents? Oh boy, old-fashioned. So finally, my mother says, you have to live in our house because she's too young to raise a baby. She didn't say nothing. She was obedient. Anyway, we moved there. The baby was born and then couldn't stand it there anymore because my mother would pick up my daughter. She'd say, hello, mama. Lily would say, I'm the mother. But she trained her, but she didn't want to admit she was old. So anyway, we bought a house. We moved to our own house then. That was the end of that story.
And where did you move to?
Not too far. Rogers Road in St. Clair area.
Okay, so by this time you would be in your 20s?
I was married, I was 24.
So tell us how your interest in getting involved in the Macedonian community developed. So you got married in the Macedonian church. And then, were you involved in the Macedonian community?
Well, first of all, I couldn't be Greek.
Okay.
It was against my principles. And the Bulgarian said, you're Bulgarian, there's no such thing as Macedonian. So I said, that's enough. And I searched United Macedonians.
Yes.
That's when I met you.
Yes, so you became involved in the United Macedonians.
Mander, remember? He was the president.
Yes.
Yes,
now here you have a wonderful plaque from the United Macedonian Organization. It says 45th anniversary presented to you, Steve Pliakes, in appreciation and recognition of your contribution to the organization and the Canadian community in Canada, in the Macedonian community in Canada. So you got that plaque in 2004. Tell us about your involvement in the United Macedonians, how it started and what it was, what it entailed.
Well, I agreed fully because I was a radical. I wanted Macedonia independence, mm-hmm. fully. And to this day, we're struggling. But, make a long story short, at least our fight, we got one small part as independent. This one, the Republic, now. So, mission accomplished to a degree.
Yeah, so when did you get involved in the United Macedonians? What year was that?
After I was established financially, I did things one step at a time. What year was that? About 80s.
In the early 80s?
Early 80s.
Early 80s. Okay, let's backtrack a little bit then about your how you established your career. When you met your wife, you bought yourself a house after a year.
Yeah.
And then what happened? How did you go about establishing your...
I was a mechanic at a garage in the same property and a house with a variety store. Lily ran the variety store, I ran the garage.
This is in Newmarket where you are now?
Where we are now.
Okay.
And that's where life began. Mm-hmm. And then I ventured into other investments right after that.
Can you tell us a little bit about what your career was like as an investor?
Well, all Macedonians are entrepreneurs.
Yes. Tell us about your entrepreneurship.
We have it in our blood. When Alexander conquered the world, and then the Romans were against it, we had to survive by hook or by crook. So we became business people, entrepreneurs, and that carried on. It's in our blood. Even today, when you see Macedonians coming over, in no time, they become business people. They're not out there being waiter. Macedonian doesn't make a good waiter. He's too proud. So I would like to say that being at the farm, I've done everything I could there, reached a certain plateau financially, but being an entrepreneur, I wanted to go more. Then I went into building, into construction. We built, I found a nice Macedonian guy partner, we became partners. We started building commercial industrial properties. And we did really good.
Mm-hmm. Were you building for Macedonians or for anybody?
Anybody. Mm-hmm. Even if a Greek wanted to rent, I rented it to him. Mm-hmm. And we did so well, I was even embarrassed to tell anyone. Mm-hmm. And if you recall one of our properties, we put I wanted to be very patriotic, I put a big billboard sign, pylon sign, Bavia Plaza, Macedonian Bavia Plaza, Macedonian Plaza. It's still there to this day, and I was proud as ever.
This is here in Toronto?
Newmarket. Uh-huh. Newmarket, yeah. Mm-hmm. And a lot of Macedonians who were leery, a little bit pro-Greek, a little bit pro-Bulgarian, and the Macedonians loved it, and they would go there and say, what idiot would put that name up there? Mm-hmm. And they used to tell them, and they said, well, what if someone breaks the window? I'm insured. Mm-hmm. Let them break the windows in the building. So to this day, you know, that sign is still there, and it's pride and joy. And I took all the big wigs, Macedonians, to see it. Mm-hmm. I don't know, you guys were pro-Yugo that time, didn't care to Macedonian nationality.
And now, Steve, you had your, you went into building, and I know that also you were involved in politics at one point.
I did.
When was that?
Well, I was in real estate.
So you became a real estate agent?
An agent. I did good there. And then I decided to go into politics, local, municipal. Mm-hmm. I was elected 2 terms.
As a?
Counselor.
For Newmarket?
Stouffville.
For Stouffville.
And I did that. I was proud and happy to do that. Mm-hmm. And because being NDP, when Bob Ray won, I said, give me a position. He made me a member of the Police Services Board in York Region. Mm-hmm. I was there, which I enjoyed it. I learned about how crooked the police are. But I was on their side. They were good people, you know. So I was on the board for enough time, which I enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. And
yes, we have a nice picture of you being one of the members of the board. Is this what... Is this with Stouffville Council?
Yeah, that is in council.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
For Stouffville?
For Stouffville.
Okay.
I enjoyed everything I did, and I don't think my life is over. Mm-hmm. And if you wanted to ask me questions, when I went to find the members of Macedonian Alexander's ancestors.
Yes, of course. We're going to talk about your Macedonian activities, because there are many.
We're
but I just didn't want to miss anything that was part of your business ventures here in Canada.
Well, I'm still in business.
Tell us about that.
Well,
you're doing
my properties. They give me rent, and I live off it. I donate to Macedonian causes, churches mainly. Mm-hmm. The Olympics, wherever. You have to give money. Sometimes you earn it, you have to mm-hmm. share it.
So mostly then you were, you started owning your mechanic shop with your partner?
No partner. I was on my own.
But at one point...
Then I went into real estate.
Yes, and at one time you said you had a Macedonian partner. Oh, was that for your...
Commercial industrial.
Can we have his name?
Jim Ripas.
Okay, so yeah. With Jim, how long were you in business with Jim?
Close to 15, 20 years.
Well, that's quite a while.
We did good. We did good together.
Construction and
building. We were good partners.
Great. So you had a lot of people working for you?
No, we didn't like people. Mm-hmm. We ran our own business. We ran it ourselves, and we leased everything we had. We rented it out, and we banked the money. Mm-hmm. That was it. When you have employees, it's cost you money.
Right. So in terms of your your activities with the Macedonian community, we mentioned the United Macedonians. Tell us about your other activities with the Macedonian community.
Well,
you were a member of United Macedonians
for quite a while. I remember when I was president, we did our first protest at the United Nations Macedonian protest. Virginia was there. 88.
Yes.
Because that was the year for Linden. We wanted independence of all Macedonian, but we didn't get it. So we went to the...
So you organized the protest in New York?
Yeah, we went to the building at the United Nations. We met the secretary of the Boutros Ghali, who he was the president. We didn't meet him. We met the secretary. We told him of our plight, and... That was the beginning of the Macedonian movement in North America. And we started that, and New Jersey followed, other cities followed, but that was the beginning to open up their hearts and move forward.
Yeah. So you were very involved in the Macedonian demonstrations that followed?
Oh, as many as you can think.
The United Macedonians organized many of them?
After a while it was a community.
Yes.
Yeah. So we did okay.
And then you became involved also in St. Clement, the church, and you were president at St. Clement?
Yes, I wanted to go there because there was a lot of fights between Macedonians and Macedonians.
Yes.
Everyone wants to think they're a somebody. Mm-hmm. When I went there, they couldn't believe because I was not from the Republic, and I was not a fanatic, so they elected me because they thought a neutral person will do good for the community, and I did that. And I got elected, and I sort of made peace with the community. That's when I got the younger people in, Jim Sharkovsky. He brought the people, and he became president.
After you?
After me.
And what year were you president?
I'd say 2000.
Around 2000?
Yeah, around mm-hmm. there, yeah.
Yes. And so then afterwards the younger generation was in...
Came in.
Board of Directors.
I opened the doors for a while and then they... We still got the old guard now. They came back. Mm-hmm. Anytime there's a club or a church or anything, the old people can't just disappear. They take over.
That's right.
Because they're harder working.
Now, I know that your involvement is very extensive with the Macedonian community, and your donations are very generous. I remember clearly you being on television with your wife on the Macedonian show, and you were being interviewed for having made a wonderful humanitarian donation to a hospital there. Can you tell us about that?
Lily's kidneys failed.
Your wife's?
So...
The health was poor. Yes,
the hospitals here called her and gave her a transplant,
a kidney transplant.
She still lives with that. Mm-hmm. So we said, God saved you. Now let's see what we can save others. So we went. I met a nice doctor in Skopje,
Macedonia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he told me where to buy a machine because he was in that field with kidneys.
This is a machine for dialysis.
For dialysis, it was, and we. Brought it over from, they brought it over, it was in Sweden, that came to Toronto, and I asked, which was a real nice guy, Mikhail Dika, he was the counselor. I said, Mikhail, help me a little bit, I'm not that loaded with money, can you ship this machine to Skopje, that was Yugoslavia then, at your expense? He says, yes, we'll do it.
So this was 1980, was in the... late 80s, right?
Yeah. And we did the, and then Mando, he says to me, Steve, don't trust the buggers. Go with the machine because they'll sell it on you. They'll steal it and sell it. So me and Lily went there. That's where we met, toured the hospital. The nicest people. You can see a person 6 feet tall, but when he's laying down, it's sad. Suffering and suffering. And I always believe to donate to the needy. It isn't, 2 years ago, we gave money to the orphanage. October 11th, there's an orphanage in Skopje. We gave money there. We helped Malapresta there.
Yes.
We helped there.
Macedonia.
I always believe where our people need a little help. Mm-hmm. And that's where I do. Not to spoil you, just enough to get you off your feet.
Right. So you donated the dialysis machine to the hospital in Skopje for the people to...
Yeah, because the Mando said to me, make sure that the army doesn't get it.
Right. Do you remember the name of the hospital?
The civilian hospital in Skopje.
Yes.
The others were army hospitals.
Right. So the main civilian hospital in Skopje.
Yeah, that was the one.
Okay. And when you were involved in the Macedonian community, I know that we have a picture of you and Macedonia's first president, Kiro Gligorov, since Macedonia became independent in 91. Can you tell us about that meeting?
I'm not sure exactly when that took place, but me and Gligorov became friends.
Okay, how did that friendship start and develop?
Well, it started because he knew I was loyal to the Macedonian cause.
And through the United Macedonians, you met him?
No, now I'm on my own.
Okay.
Okay. And I liked him. He was a good man. It doesn't matter what anyone says. To the best of his ability, what was in his power, he served Macedonia. He put us on the map. He prevented. We didn't lose any lives and everything else. And I couldn't care less what party that was or is or whatever. And as a matter of fact, he was so good that he gave me his personal phone number from his house that he lived Vodno, up in the Skopje there. Mm-hmm. And I used to call him periodically. We exchanged ideas.
Okay.
He trusted me with my honesty. And I needed him to give me his views. And we did good together. Really, really.
So
and
you we consulted met, with each other.
Yes, we did quite a bit of that.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't discuss it with other people. It was just personal. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I know that you also got lots of other accomplishments and certificates, and there's one award certificate here. It's the Svetska Makedonski Congress, the World Macedonian Congress. You've become an honorary senator. Tell us about that.
To this day, I believe
we
need the Macedonian Congress, especially the Macedonians, the Aegean Macedonians, Pyrrhon Macedonia, and Malapa. We need that. The Republic does need the Congress. So I always strived and worked towards getting it, but we haven't done it yet. I don't know why. You can't accomplish everything you want.
But the group, the Congress, has made some activities,
Well, it still exists in Bitola, in Skopje. Mm-hmm. Todor Petrov is still the president, a very nice person.
And they do activities and actions for the community from time to time?
No, nothing activities. They're actually working towards, if one country is against us, they want to exploit it and bring them out in the open, like that. That's the Congress. Make our people aware what Greece does, what Bulgaria does. Okay, so that's the purpose of the Congress. You have to be away from the country, which now is the Republic, because we don't want to get them in trouble, because, others can say, you guys are working with the Congress and they're against us. No, we separated from that, and still the Congress is on its own.
So your involvement with the Congress is ongoing?
Not much.
But when you got the certificate, What was that in honor of?
My history.
Yes, your contributions to the Macedonian.
Because I've known Todor Petrov before he even shaved.
Right, and you've made a lot of contributions. I know that we've got a wonderful picture of you here at the Olympics. Can you tell us how you became involved in the Macedonian Olympics?
I, being a patriot, and being banned from going to Greece to this day.
Tell us about that. You've tried to go back?
Oh, many times.
And what has happened?
I sneak in now.
Right, but when you tried officially, what happened?
Well, officially you're a fool because they'll send you back.
And they've done that to you?
Oh yeah, and you work differently. I learned it from Vino Gito.
Okay.
What to do, what not to do. So as far as the movement, where were we, by the way? Fill me in.
Yes, let's talk about first of all that bit when you're
the Olympics.
Yes.
Okay, I always wanted to go and march in Athens because supposedly they said that were the first Olympics and Alexander was supposed to have done supposedly, and I wanted to be the first Macedonian Aegean to walk there. There was the other were from the Republic, but I was the only one, and it cost me, of course, normally it does. And I marched on the stadium with the flag bearer. I couldn't carry the flag because you have to be an athlete. And the biggest pride and joy to walk as a Macedonian in a country that denied you the rights.
So you walked as a Macedonian with a Macedonian delegation?
The stadium.
In the stadium when all the countries
yes,
came
yes, yes.
in for
they
the Olympics.
They called the names, then ours, and then I looked, must have been 1,000 cameras focusing, and I thought, boy, oh boy, where are somebody? Now, this is how you do your advertising to the world, Macedonia with the Olympics. And that's when I also decided then to start a Macedonian Olympic, Canadian Macedonian Olympic Club here. And because I wanted us to move forward, exploit the idea to be good for all Macedonians. I couldn't care less, you call it Yugoslavian, Macedonian you are, I accept you. I didn't care anything
so
else.
So you help to support Macedonian athletes?
All the time.
And this is from your generous contributions?
Yeah, yes. Oh, it cost me a fortune. You guys don't come cheap.
Right, so where did you participate? The Macedonian committee participated in Athens Olympics?
And Beijing.
And so you also supported in Beijing?
I walked there too.
You walked in Beijing
as
well?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And tell us about, were there lots of people with you or how did that?
Well, don't forget we're a small country in Macedonia. We had a small number of athletes, a little more delegation in Greece and less in China, but it didn't matter. The cameras focused, the flag, the Macedonian people, the announcements.
And what did they announce Macedonia as?
Yes.
Macedonia or Fyrom?
Not Greece, China, but not Greece. Fyrom, that was Greece wouldn't accept you any other way. So you had to say Fyrom and you have no choice.
So the Chinese had to say it that way in order to...
Yeah, it's a problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and so your involvement in the Olympics, bringing forth the Macedonian participation in the Olympics was important for you, and you contributed.
Self-serving. But I was proud.
But you were also, Macedonia was being represented.
That was the greatest pride.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you did it for that reason. And along with that, I know that you also had a very special expedition to...
That was before. Before the Olympics.
Before the Olympics, yes. Tell us about your very special expedition to the... this was the Hunza?
Yes.
A group in Pakistan?
The Alexander's leftover army that was there. But you see...
So the Hunza people say that they are from...
Descendants of Alexander. And they said they're children of Alexander. They said that.
And where do they live at the moment?
All same place when they left 2,000 years ago. In the river, Indus River, the gorge, they built themselves huts, and they're still there to this day.
And they say they're from?
They're descendants of Alexander.
Mm-hmm.
But let me tell you what prompted me to do the trip. when Macedonia got their referendum,
91, yes.
I asked Grigor, I said, what's our history? How far does it go? Oh, he says, what are you asking me? 1943, when they joined the Yugoslavia.
When Macedonia became a Republic of Yugoslavia.
Yeah. I said, that's not good enough. I said, the Greeks and Bulgarians will eat us alive. We need our roots, like the Jews have their roots. So I was prompted then to make a trip there.
To
find the footsteps of Alexander and to come back and tell you people that our roots go 2,300 years, not 44, like Grigorov said. I asked Bitov, he didn't have a clue either. So I was prompted to go there. I did, I found the people.
Yes, who did you find? How did you
the locals. Well, I followed the National Geographic. There were others who came in. They wrote, and I went to the Smithsonian Institute. I did a little searching there.
This was by yourself?
And another mastering guy, Michael Keithley from Indiana.
Yes.
Indianapolis. The two of us. No one else would come. They were scared to death.
And tell us a little about Michael Keithley. He is a?
Like high school teacher or like a professor in history. We got along really good.
And his Macedonian roots?
Oh, yes. Born in the States, but the Macedonian. I said, Michael, I know you're young. Come, I'll pay for everything, I just need your company. And he said, okay. But he was so patriotic, young person, wanted to move forward the movement.
Yes.
So why wouldn't he? But the other guys that I asked, yes, 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 the last minute, I said, let's get the tickets ready. They got scared. Mm-hmm. For many reasons, and I don't respect them. I know who they are. Anyway, Michael's the only one.
So
I wanted a team.
Two people?
I wanted a team. I needed a linguist. I needed a cameraman. Couldn't get him. Michael was the only one.
So you and Michael went together?
Yeah.
And tell us about how that trip was.
We landed in, from Detroit, we took the plane to London, England, and then to Rawalpindi. It used to be the old capital city of Pakistan. We landed there and then hired a jeep and went north toward the Hunza that you're saying. We went there and it wasn't easy. It was monsoon time, season. Monsoon means rain steady for 30 days. Bridges were being washed in front of our eyes and everything. It was dangerous. No Al-Qaeda then. It was the weather. It was the problem. And we actually... I enjoyed the movement because I was always almost there to meet our people. And when we met them in some villages, they wouldn't accept me as a Macedonian yet. I said to myself, oh boy, now what do I do? Because many others went before. So I brought my souvenirs like Columbus and I showed them out. The flag, this, coins, whatever I had. Hey, that's ours. Oh, we did it. Struck it rich. So I said, yes, it is ours. And then they accepted me slowly. They invited me to their house. They cooked their chicken and rice and that. And they said, do you drink wine? I says, I thought you live over here. No, we're not Muslims. We're not Pakistanis. We're Macedonians. Oh, I flipped. Mm-hmm. So anyway, they took me around. When we after dinner, they took me around to the cemetery. In those days, in the early years, they did not bury their people. They left the coffin on top of the ground because you can go up to heaven. If they buried you, you're a bad guy if you went down. So they showed me that. That's where I found that road that Alexander's army built.
Yes, we have a really nice picture
That's the road the Macedonian army marched on. The army built the roads and they marched on it.
This is Alexander's army.
Only Alexander's army.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And the people told you that?
Of course. That's the only ones. And I said, how do you know all of this? Oh, our elders. History at those times carried on word of mouth from people to people. There was nothing else for them. And it was, to me, I said, take me around the little village. Not too many houses. And I look on one of the doors, the sunburst, the flag. This one. Exactly. With the middle, the Zdravets, the flower. Okay. That's what I saw at the door. I said, Michael, come here. We went. He said, take a look. We shot the pictures. That sort of reconfirmed our history. And when I saw that and everything else, and now, those that wanted to be Macedonians, they already were, but, and those that didn't want to believe, who cares? Mm-hmm. So that's where I found this flag, and to this, I made these pins, because I still believe that should be our flag of the future. Now, for political reasons, it's not yet, but the youth in the Republic accepted this to be their flag, and we'll leave that to future times, whatever happens. So I stayed there for quite a while. We discussed, we talked.
Did you meet any of their elders or any of their...
We did. We spent, well, I don't know who they are. They're nice people.
They were like the head of the village or...
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like the counselors?
This is not a big village. You know, they would have one person who would be the spokesperson.
Yes.
And he would do that. Mm-hmm. And then they had an interpreter that knew English.
So they spoke in their own language, and
they have their mixture of dialect. They said, mm-hmm. I didn't have a linguist. They have leftover Macedonian words from Alexander's period, mm-hmm. and some were thrown in as Urdu. It's called the Muslim mm-hmm. language, the Pakistani, and that's sort of what they spoke.
And you had a person who is interpreting for you?
One guy, but I could almost figure everything out, what they were saying.
So there were a lot of Macedonian words in the way they spoke?
Not that much. Mm-hmm. But don't forget, it's been lost. Okay? Mm-hmm. And if I had a linguist, I don't know. I did ask one linguist from Australia, Shashile. Mm-hmm. He led me to believe, okay, and then he backed out on me. I couldn't get anyone. So... as a matter of fact, mission accomplished for as I was concerned. Came back, documented everything with Michael, gave it to the known Macedonians then. They put it, media was free then. Aha! Mm-hmm. They could say and do anything. And it was printed all over. The Greeks, that's when they decided to ban me from going to Greece.
You made a little book of
Michael
your,
wrote it. Wrote the same story, but yes. Michael did the writing, and I've given it away in English and Macedonian.
Mm-hmm. So you put a book together about your expedition?
A little pamphlet.
Yes?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And it was mission accomplished as far as I was concerned. Everyone saw it. Like I said, Greece banned me from going to Greece because how can you change history? It's already documented, written that Greece is the oldest. Alexander was Greek. I said, no, it wasn't. There's proof. I saw people telling me there is that they're from Alexander, who was Macedonian, from the land of Macedonia. Mm-hmm. They hate me. That's to this day, the Greeks. And sorry about some of you, Bulgaria. Mm-hmm. Oh, how could they do that? We're all Bulgarian. Bulgaria never existed that time. They came around 1,100 years ago.
So you've had quite a lot of you've spent some time then when you came back from the Hunzas. How long was your expedition with the Hunzas?
3 weeks.
3 weeks. So where did you stay there? Like when you?
Oh.
Yes.
High class hotels, tents.
Uh huh.
Yeah.
You stayed in
tents
together with the
Michael.
People.
Yeah.
Yeah, with Michael
and the people.
Yes.
And they would go. Actually, it was out of season. They would catch fish and they would buy them, but it was illegal. Okay, so our driver would cook them for us, and a little bit illegal, but mm-hmm. we enjoyed it.
Right. So you just basically roughed it out for yeah, 3 weeks.
I remember going from territory to territory, because these were warlords. They owned the territory, but they were decent. I had to pay dues to go from one area to another. And as a matter of fact, it was such a way, if I wrote down where I'm from, Macedonia, you're in. Mm-hmm. And they told Michael, I said, get rid of anything American. Why? I said, they all hate you. Mm-hmm. I said, Macedonia, I gave him a Canadian flag that we respected to put on his briefcase and that. And I said, now you're Macedonia only. And we wrote down strictly Macedonia. And one time one guy, he said, this is my valley, my kingdom. He says, it was left to me. He says, what are you doing here? He says, trying to find the footsteps of Alexander to tell our people. What do you mean? He says, the whole world knows who Alexander was, Macedonian. You guys don't know and you're Macedonians? Sad. And I don't mean just one region. All four regions of Macedonia, I'd say 10% knew.
Yes, and you were certainly a pioneer in going by the footsteps of Alexander.
We faced death a couple of times.
Because the Hunza's leaders, the king and the Lira. King, visited
me. I went to find him. No, I was the first to find him.
Did you find him?
I found him there. I went to the gates. He had a palace, a cheap little place. But so the guard says, I said, I want to see the Mir. No, you can't.
So his name is Mir.
That's a title, Mir, yeah. He says, no, you can't. I says, go ask him. He goes over, he says, doesn't accept anyone. I say, I want you to go back again. You're going to tell him. I'm not leaving. I came all the way from Macedonia to meet him. I'm not leaving this gate. He went over and he says, come tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock. And we had breakfast and everything else. He told me his whole life story. He was, his family was for 800 years the dynasty. He says, look at my eyes. And I took pictures on the camera, blue eyes. He says, Macedonian father, Iranian woman, my mother. That's what our army grabbed all the young girls for the soldiers. So blue eyes, Macedonian men, dark skin, Macedonian women. And so we had quite a chat, but the Republic wasn't ready yet. They were in the turmoil about anything. They weren't ready to start anything till just now, 2-3 years ago, when they brought him over.
Yes, he came over, I think, in the 2012, something like that, 13. Yes, so you were the first to see the real chief, the Mir.
I went there only. We had the referendum. What is our history? Where's our roots? If you don't have roots, you're a dead man. So I decided to go find our roots, come here, and convince those that wanted to be to accept it. And then it started flourishing. Now they tell me it's in grade 5 curriculum. In some of the books, they're teaching the Alexander history, supposedly. So, for me, mission accomplished.
Steve, you want to share some interesting information about history, religious, religion and history? Please go ahead.
Okay. Constantine the first emperor of the Romans, was a Macedonian. He was born somewhat, Prilep, my village, your village, whatever. He was Macedonian. He became a Christian through his mother. He was stationed as a Macedonian in the Roman legions in Byzantine, in today Istanbul. He became a general there, and through his mother, Christianity, but Christianity came when St. Pablo, St. Paul, went to Macedonia. He went there because, now remember, the Jews and the Romans were persecuting anyone that was religious. But in Macedonia, was we were still powerful enough under Alexander, although we were under the Romans, but we were still independent in our own way. So St. Paul went there, preached the word about Jesus, which at the time it was needed. It was at the moment of what they call it the Dark Ages. When there's Dark Ages, there's chaos, there's no rule in the world, and everybody does whatever they want. That's he went there, and that's sort of when Christianity began. When they needed to make people accept and become Christian. It was by any means whatever it is, because when there's a chaos, it's terrible for human beings. So that's then after St. Paul, Constantine came over and knocked the atheists in Rome. He put himself the leader of the Roman church, and being he was all Macedonian. So I'm saying through us, the Macedonians, the window to Christianity came from us, from the Macedonians. Nowhere else, because they were being persecuted everywhere. As a matter of fact, the Colosseum in Rome, the Romans used to throw all the Christians there because they feared them for another uprising. And if you've heard Spartacus, he was Macedonian, although people will tell you, no, he was Thracian, but any excuse not, he was Macedonian. He was the one that the Romans threw in the Colosseum, and he fought for his belief. He wanted to restart the Macedonian power again, but it didn't happen. But Spartacus was Macedonian. We were persecuted by everyone. As a matter of fact, to this day, even the Republic is having a problem. We're doing good. We're proud people, but religion to Christianity came through Macedonia. Who says anything? Because St. Paul, Constantine, on and on and on. It was the St. John, St. Mary, the Jesus mother. Okay, she was actually in hiding because they were chasing Christians, followers of Jesus. So St. John, not the Baptist, the apostle, went, took her from the territory that she lived in, Palestine, took her over in Byzantine, which is part Macedonian territory, where over there in Istanbul, took her there, and she finished her last years of her life, died there. And I went to her grave twice to see where she's buried and everything else. So it was all Macedonian movement all along, all the time. So, and then Constantinople, which is named after Constantine the First, nothing to do with the Greeks. The Greeks, like the Americans, want to steal the history. So as far as anyone is concerned, we are in a way, the world is sort of, they don't want us to rise again. Either they're jealous because we're capable, or whatever, but that's fine. We have to find ourselves and move forward and regroup somehow. We can do it, but we need, because we've been persecuted for 100 years, and it's not easy to rise when you've been brainwashed all along through fear and any other tactics.
Right, and you've definitely spent a lot of your time trying to bring the Macedonian reality to the mm-hmm. generation and to this point in history. And I know that in your personal life you have children and grandchildren, and I know that you're very proud as well of this picture. Can you tell us a little bit about who are your grandchildren and your children?
I have 4 grandkids, 2 daughters of my own, and each one has a boy and a girl.
And their names, the girls?
Margaret and Jeannie, and the boys are the grandkids are Stephen, Christopher, Angela, and Stephanie. And I got married at the St. Clement's. My kids were born, baptized at St. Clement's, and married at St. Clement's. And their kids baptized at the St. Clement's Church. So we never moved anywhere. There's other churches, but that's the roots where it all began. Mm-hmm. So, and they feel Macedonian now. How much? They are total Macedonian patriotic, but they're Canadianized a lot too. So mm-hmm. you can't take it away from them. They're good.
Right, and Steve, all along, in many, many, many parts of your life, you got involved in the Macedonian community. You wanted to make a difference. You certainly did a lot of things to make a difference. Tell us what motivated you all along to give of your time, of your financial resources to the Macedonian cause.
We are, like they say in English, we're a somebody. We're capable people. I did my life in business. I reached as far as I wanted to go. There's no limit. I couldn't care less any more money to make. So the way I see it, you have to show your pride with your nationality, as a Macedonian, call it nationality or whatever, but that is the biggest pride and joy. A Jew has been fighting all his life to become a Jew in other countries. So we have a history, as long as the Jews, it's time the world should recognize, but the main theme is to know yourself. If we know ourselves as Macedonian, proud, capable people, that's all that counts. And then from there we move forward and show others the way. So we are special. Really, we are. Through religion, we rule the world during the Alexander's period. And that's not easy. Okay, he, in his own way, he ruled. Okay, we're all proud as Macedonians, and we're powerful. We're somebody. Okay, so we should never stop. I know we're under control of other countries, Albania, Greece, and Bulgaria, and each one has their own tactics. I think someday we will unite. I do believe, because I never believed that, no, I shouldn't say I never believed, my wish was to unite more, but the republic we made, okay, that's a start-up point. And we got movements in Greece, Macedonians dancing and speaking and music, all Macedonian. I'm sure in Bulgaria too, but they suppress us. Malapraspa is the only one in Albania give us the most freedom, because the mayor, Edmund Temelko, he actually named some streets in Malapraspa there. Pustić, I think, is the town. What's a Delta, Diamond Grove, the streets and everything, and the church. I helped give him quite a bit of money to finish that church.
And this is the church in Malapraspa?
Yeah, yeah.
The Albanian part of Macedonia?
Yes, mm-hmm. Okay.
And what church is that, Steve? Sveta Petka, no?
I'm not sure, it doesn't matter. Okay. Makedonska Crkva.
Crkva. Okay.
Okay, and as far as Albania is concerned, they were not as fanatic towards us as the other two.
Yes.
And if anything I should say, and the Serbs have been good to us, they never fought us. They gave us the Republic in the silver platter. I said, you must have been drunk for us to take it away from you. So, and the Serbs are good, still are good people. They're our best friends, and the Albanians. But politically, the Bulgarians are inching closer. Did you know that Skopje and Sofia are twinned, the two cities? Okay, Greece not yet.
Mm-hmm. And Steve, we've touched on many, many of your activities, and you've given us a lot of really interesting information. Is there anything that that really is close to your heart that you're really proud of that you were able to accomplish?
Everything I did, I'm proud of. Even talking to you. Hopefully you'll become stronger Macedonian. That's what I'm proud of. Especially I'm proud of your son. More than you and your husband. Your son more. There's a real forward-moving partisan.
Yes. Let's talk about the young people. You are an example of a very successful Macedonian immigrant who came to Canada and was able to really build a meaningful, prosperous life. What advice do you have for the young generations, like your grandchildren, like my son?
Listen to your parents.
What would you like to tell them to be successful? Yeah.
Listen to your parents, go to church, and become friendly with your people there, because no matter who else you want to be, when all else fails, you are Macedonian. Yes, they do like to talk to us, all the other nationalities, but they're too busy working for their own nationalism, and we're Macedonians, so be proud and be one. Go to the churches, go to the picnics, marry Macedonians, only.
And how about nešto da mu kažem na roditeljite, for the parents? Šo sakaš da mu kažeš na pomladite roditelji šo ima deca, kako vašite džini i drugoto devojče? Šo sakaš niv da mu kažeš za nivni, šo da pravat vo nivniot život so decata, so nivnite novi generaciji?
One emergency is again a death stock on
Makedonski. Uh-huh.
Yeah, ako ne naučit makedonski, ja si makuto za mojte. Ako ne naučit makedonski, polovinta se zginaja identity to show je. Треба да ги учат македонски, да се учат македонски, ќе учат на, на хората, на църквите, на пикниците. Окей, много ме били, не знам, не се познам. Абе, аз никой не знаеш, кога ти да ги види люйта. Поляка, поляка, тие се па, тие па, тие, ке се сопниш, ке се речи хало, ке се гушниш, тие се нашите люйга. Други никой не те сака. Истина така, нема гайле. Води не вода никой път, бе, нашите егейци живот на гърцко, Прай, гъркам веле, няма същи гмезани. Си гряд дома, у нас къде гряд. Бугариям веле, няма, македонци, цели сте бугари. Ай си гряд и у нас. Со, да си учите децата, и вие да се учите, да си мислите, се знаете, ама да си укрепте патриотизмата, македонското са то са силите. И здравите ми носи то, не само сила.
Стив, од името на сите нас тука во Canadian Macedonian Historical Society, сакаме да ти кажеме многу сполајти што дојде тука од твоето време што ни даде и што ни ги кажа твоите многу интересни истории во твојот живот. We really appreciate you coming here and sharing with us your very, very interesting stories and contributions to the Macedonian community. And we want to tell you again that it's been a pleasure and we hope that you will continue to spread your love and patriotism.
I hope our listeners will take the torch, the Macedonian cause. It's not a one-man show. Everyone should do their bit. Everyone. And you're doing your bit. Zoran is every all of us, and pass it on to the kids.
And you definitely started it, especially marching in both Olympics were most recent.
Hey. The Greeks didn't like me. They wanted to ban me out. And I said, can't throw me out because I came through the World Olympics. They approved me.